We've got that.
So can you see the main screen?
You're not on slideshow at the moment.
I will be in a second then.
Yeah, it seems like it's deciding what to do. So do you want to introduce yourselves first of all?
I'm going to hand to Graham for him to introduce himself and then I'll come in.
Yeah, hello everybody. I'm Gareth Rees. I'm currently based in Peru, but as you can tell from my accent, I'm actually from New Zealand. And so I'm familiar with backcasting for trout as well as backcasting for planning. So I don't know if I'd be able to help you with your casting, but we'll certainly be able to talk about planning here today. So I'm with Chris here. We're both in Copenhagen presenting to you today.
So you should be able to see the full screen. My name is Chris Scotter. I'm the Policy Advisor for Human Resources for Health here in the WHO Regional Office for Europe. I can't remember how long I've been here, but sufficiently long to feel at home, shall I put it that way. I know nothing about backcasting for fish, I'm afraid. You'd probably end up catching cans if I helped out. So we're here today to talk briefly about introducing backcasting as a method for workforce planning. I'm not going to take too much of a preamble, but we'll move on to the next slide. So we all know that HRH planning can be problematic, and we know that getting human resources for health planning perfect is virtually impossible. But it is about ensuring you have the right people with the right skills and delivering the right services in the right place in a timely fashion. Most common forecasting models are used to estimate the future numbers. The models are only as good as the data available, and they represent a system as it is or has been, and they're accurate for a limited amount of time. And from the WHO's point of view and from the system outside in the big wide world, as it were, not just in the UK, there are always problems with finding the right numbers in the right places at the right time, simply because there are a number of issues dealing with it. But I think the key one that we see is that the governance isn't always there behind the system. Planning capability is limited and data is poor, but also, and a key one here is around the scope in which planning tends to take place. Very often it's limited by political choices. And so planning has a relatively short time horizon if you consider the political time horizon too. So one of the things that the impact of that is that when we're trying to maintain the balance between supply and demand, what we find is that we end up with a misalignment between the labour market. You end up where education and training doesn't necessarily meet the supply, and you get skills mismatch, poor qualities, over and under supply issues. Where your demand and actually the health needs don't necessarily feature through proper assessment, we see massive elements of unmet need, both in geographic and income disparities and access issues. And then there is the balance between supply and demand, where you can have under or oversupply, you can end up with unemployment, emigration, vacancies, labour shortages. So the labour market really is a function between education and supply, demand and health needs, and supply and demand. And some of that balance is maintained from inputs from education, but emphasis has to be on policies, and policies that maintain the existing workforce, both in numbers and quality, but also taking account for the future workforce requirements. Now, currently, the WHO has produced a health labour market analysis and health labour market toolkit, which seeks to support member states around the world to develop more sophisticated approaches to planning. And what we're working on the basis that the labour market is really a function between education, the labour market dynamic, and the delivery of services. And so governments, when they're thinking about working with the labour market, need to be thinking about not just the workforce in place, but they need to be thinking about the economy, the population and the broader society drivers. I think governments generally need to get to grips with the fact that they're competing for workers from not just in the health area, but using the 2006 definition. Anybody who works in the labour in the health system is a health is a labour market is a lab, is a health worker. Sorry. So countries need to think about policies on production. So the infrastructure, the materials, the enrolments into education, the selection of students, and the teaching of staff. And in the UK, in the past, we've seen things like recruiting for values and things like that, which sort of attempt to make sure the fit between people coming out of education and going into the health market is a better fit, improves retention, improves skills, matches, etc., and improves patient care. We think about policies to address inflows and outflows. Now, the UK is a net well, it used to be a net importer. I'm not entirely sure that's the case at the moment. The last time I worked in the UK system, I would say it was probably a balance of inflow and outflow. Probably as many workers leaving the UK as are joining the UK from outside. Brexit has changed that dynamic, but it's interesting to note that a lot of workers going into the African region come from the UK and Ireland. But countries need to think about policies that address migration and emigration, that seek to minimise the number of unemployed health workers and bring health workers back into the healthcare sector that are moved on to other sectors, perhaps. Pharmacy is a big one. In the UK, the biggest healthcare provider is the NHS by a country mile. But in other countries, it's not the same. There's a high competition with the private sector. And you go from places like the United States and Georgia, which are heavily privatised systems, to places in northwestern and northern Europe, which are heavily based around either Bismarckian models or beverage models, which end up with a significant public sector provision, albeit balanced off with various sizes of private market. There's got to be policies within this, and we to deal with maldistribution and inefficiencies, and that seeks to look at productivity and performance. Looking at the correct skill mix and to retain health workers in underserved areas. And talking about the private sector, it's not a significant player in the UK market, but in other countries it is. And so there has to be issues about managing dual practice, improving the quality of training and enhancing service delivery, particularly as workers go between the poorest boundaries of public sector and private sector. The overall intent of this is a workforce that really looks to deliver care at the services that the health service require and the population demand. And when we talk about population demand, we're not talking about the need, their wish for plastic surgery, et cetera, et cetera. We talk about demand in terms of the health service promise to the public. This is what we are going to provide, and this is what you might expect for us. And that's the demand we talk about. The message we're trying to get across to member states, all member states, is sustainable workforces need sustainable planning systems. And that requires political and leadership commitment. It needs planning organisation within the health system. And I know in the UK there are planning organisations. You have NES in Scotland, you have HEE in England. Similarly, you have setups in Northern Ireland and Wales. But the number of countries that you will discover have little in terms of planning organisation is quite significant. The other thing is about HR data availability and HRH data that is properly accurate and it has integrity. And those are key things that must sit in place. And we do find significant weaknesses in all three of those areas in various degrees in various countries. And a lot of the political stroke leadership commitment is driven by political structures, driven by the length of time that government might be into power. And there are other consequences of the political culture that exists in a society. But the biggest weaknesses that are probably controllable within a country are the planning and the data. So we see four types of HRH planning in existence at the moment. There's the serendipitous process, heavily supply side reliant, very little formal planning or intervention by governments, and it relies on the output of health education and cultural career preference of the individuals choosing their education. And what we see happening there is heavy emphasis on doctors and specialisms within doctors. And the weaknesses of this system is that there is no consideration of the system demand. So what happens is, as I say, you end up with heavily weighted thing supply side on specialist doctors, low densities of nurses and allied health professions, and even the general practice and family practice areas can be undersupplied, and sometimes quite significantly. That impacts upon the ability to deliver primary health care, that impacts on the quality of the first level services, and an over reliance on acute level services. Patients then tend to self-select and bypass primary health care, and they go into the most costly part of the health system. And there's no secret that we see that happening in the UK. People do self-select to go to accident emergency. It was casualty when I was last there. But it reduces the ability of the health system to develop and to embrace changes that can give patient development benefits. All the money is tied up in delivering acute services or paying for the impact of going to private sector. The replacement or gap-filling model that applies is a little bit more sophisticated in its approach, but not massively, I don't think. But it tends to rely on ratio-based models and reactive HRH planning. So this hospital has X number of beds, and that equates to X number of doctors and Y number of nurses. Very often leads to mismatch between what the system demands and what they're able to provide. And it has a high propensity to be poor in reacting to demographic shocks. And it is incredibly slow to react and change. And we see that a lot in countries that are historically have command economies and central planning. And it also has challenges in data. So, and with that poor data, the replacement tends to lag behind loss, and very often actually doesn't even keep pace with the loss. And you end up with a divergence from even that ratio-based model. Stock and flow systems are very common. In Holland, they have a very sophisticated and very well used stock and flow model, which is very, very effective. Population in Holland isn't one of the largest in Europe, but it is quite effective in that area, in that country. Other countries use stock and flow to a greater or lesser effectiveness, but stock and flow estimates the replenishment level for the workforce, and it does have an element of request of looking at the future demand on that workforce in terms of numbers, and it tries to calculate the optimal yearly inflow between balance and demand. So it does take into account things like outflow. It does take into account system changes, and the more complex models even have elements of scenario planning in there. But it does need government support and consensus. It tends to work on a worker type. And therefore, when you are using stock and flow modelling, you need to layer those plans, individual plans, between professional groupings or non-clinical, non-professional groups. And understand the dynamics between those. So system change does require you to look at multiple models working at the same time. The final approach that has been trialled in a number of countries, well, a few number of countries, the UK had the Centre for Workforce Intelligence, which was an opportunity and an attempt to try and foresight models. Australia tried something similar a little earlier, but both countries have actually moved away from the centre or the Australian model. But the features of strategic planning is that it tends to look at complex dynamics within health systems, relies on qualitative, not just quantitative information. And the qualitative information is the future need aspects. And things like expert elicitation can help in determining the path of services and what that might look like, and therefore have some form of estimate in terms of the planning requirement in terms of workforce. But it gives a very general view of where to go. But the idea within strategic planning is a bit like sailing. The idea is not necessarily to get it right first time, but just to keep your hand on the tiller and keep making small tweaks as you proceed down the timeline. But it's very complex and has wide confidence margins generally, and much wider the further out you go. And for that reason, it's probably to use it in the short term, because of the complexity of it, stock and flow tends to be much more efficient. And in the long term, it requires significant investment, both in time and in money to develop this. So it can be useful. And I know that some of the reports that came out of the Australian model and the UK model were very, very, very good. But there were reports that supported long-term thinking about which direction should move. In effect, it's much more effective when you talk about planning for skills or anticipating the need for skills rather than looking at specific professions. So if you can look at a care pathway and think about, well, if we're going to be delivering these services in this way in 15 to 20 years' time, what are the skills going to look like? And what impact can that have on skills mix and the variation of staffing models? So it can have utility in that respect. But as you go from left to right on this, they become more complex. And as I say, on the far right-hand side, strategic planning is probably not used at all by any country at the moment. And it's the most sophisticated models we see generally switch between stock and flow-based systems of varying degrees of complexity. But the end result we are finding in the workforces around the world is that in countries around the world and the health systems, is there is generally an imbalance between the workforce required and the stock of workers there and the future supply side. And that's partially down to...
Sorry, Chris, 5-minute warning.
Okay, I'll be nearly done. So I'm going to hand over to Gareth to move to the next phase, and then we'll...
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Chris. So as we can see there, then what we have is we have this systems where we have increasing complexity and the problems become increasingly complex for us. So what do we do? How may we reconcile this complexity and this complexity with our implementation strategies there? And so the literature and some of the studies that I've been participating in say that we need to be thinking a little bit more about an adaptive approach and being a little bit more open in the types of tools and the range of activities that we'll put in place. And so this is the idea of introducing a new tool such as backcasting. And the models that Chris provided us show us that we can actually improve some of the models. We can improve our forecasts, or we can be more systematic about it. But rethinking the way that we look at our workforce and the way that we plan can also help us in terms of coming up with better ways to identify what's needed and how we can put that in place. And so this is looking beyond the numbers to start understanding how we can achieve the outcomes that we desire for our workforce. And so what we're doing here is we're starting to move away from forecasting, which is one of the methods that we use for planning services, into foresight, which you can see there has a longer time horizon and starts letting us think about how future workforces may develop, but it also is affected by uncertainty and emerging trends. And one way to overcome this is to think about what we call normative future studies. This is, and the time horizon is a little bit longer, but to think about the desirable work, the desirable health future that we want, and what would be the workforce that we require for that. And then what we can do is we can then add some of that expert knowledge and help us more better define how our workforce may adapt and adopt new methods. And this is where we see health as what we call a normative future. And this is a desirable future which has consensus from the members of the health system. And so here we see future action achieving something that is desirable for us. So it's a target that we want to reach or a goal that we want to achieve. And this normative future tells us or asks us the question, how do we get there? What do we need to do? Healthcare is generally normative because it's not going to change too much. We know that there are health needs out there, and we know that technology and other aspects of healthcare are slow to change. And so this, while it still gives us some uncertainty, can help us devising better policies as we move forward. And so generally, backcasting is the way that we can use this normative future to help us with planning, because what we're doing is we're looking at the desirable future and then looking backwards from that desirable future to the present and seeing what do we have to do to make this a reality. And so what we can confront there is the challenges to reaching these long-term goals, or look for what are these trends that are going to be part of the problem that we need to overcome. And so it's not like looking from the present to the future. We're looking from the future backwards to our present and seeing what do we need to do. And that helps us with sequencing and coming up with policies that will help us move forward there. We can see here in this little diagram where we have our preferred future or goal that we want, and we can then examine key dimensions of that in our planning. And we can have what are called signposts, and these might be targets or goals, sub-goals that we set. And each of these targets will have obstacles to achievement and opportunities, and there'll be actions associated with those to achieve that. So we can see again, it's from the future to the present. And then what we do is we take this into a strategic planning type format, where we take this view and then we move it through a number of steps here. And the key step there we can see is step number three, which is the backcasting analysis. And here we're involving people to understand what the situation is and using analytical tools and methods to help us identify those key areas or those key times that we need to have for our backcasting analysis to work. And so this backcasting analysis phase is really about identifying what, how, and who are going to deal with those opportunities and those obstacles and putting actions into place. What changes do we need to make? How can we realize these changes and who does that? And then we can have a driver or barrier analysis that we can put into practice through actions that lead us to be able to achieve that desired future.
So just quickly now to look at the application of backcasting to the HRH problem, John, two slides, so we'll be there. So most systems have a set of preferred models of care, funding parameters and system organising, and the problem is to set within that normative frame. And what backcasting does is to apply that process in that five-step review that Gareth was talking about earlier. And if you use your strategic plan, for example, as your normative point, if you can consider what within your planning horizon and stretch that planning horizon out, but use that same strategic, assume that that strategy will be in place for some period of time. So the idea is to understand what that means in terms of the strategic direction. What is the desired future? What is that strategic requirement in terms of core function and required workforce? And assessing the current workforce to match those future models, and understanding what the gap between the two pictures are. That will give some insight into required cadres and skills and the competencies and what those gaps are. And that's your backcasting piece. That's the demand analysis to look at what you may need in that normative future and what you currently have. And then that allows you to develop that plan in your fourth step here to look at how to close that workforce gap through a sustainable pathway. And then a normal annual or other review to build into this process that where that changes over time, it allows you to embed actions that lead to that desired future. Now, I know too many of you sit there and think that's what workforce planning actually is, but the reality is that's not what happens. There are many, many times that actually countries, even like the UK and Germany and Holland, step into replacement because the nature of the funding models, because the nature of the emergency, because the nature of what's going on at the particular moment in time, the drift back into, well, we just do repeat the exercise that we did last year. By setting a normative future in stone earlier, you can move towards that within the planning within sufficient time to make changes to the workforce.
I'm going to have to hurry you, Chris. If you've got one more slide.
I have got one more slide. And I'd like to change it.
Fraser.
There we go. So the application of backcasting, the tool has utility for planning and it helps policymakers and stakeholders look at the future with a bit more certainty. Stakeholders can see their part in it and know what they need to do. So educators, service providers, and it gives policy an option. We believe it gives policymakers the option to rehearse policy and look at the consequences and the sequencing and costing. Progress can be made, we believe, without having a full strategic plan for the horizon, but using existing strategic directions and strategic planning goals. Gives you early wins and progress can be measured pretty effectively. And those plans can be designed as roadmaps and using and signposts. But it's adaptable enough that as those strategic plans change, you can then reset your normative as you go forward. So I'm going to end there with thanks to Gareth and thanks to you, John, and hand over for questions.
Thank you both. Thank you, Chris and Gareth. Quick questions then, anybody at all? Do feel free to just unmute and let's ask. I've got to chuck in the obvious one is, look, here we are in the United Kingdom. We've got Scotland, which has got workforce issues and unfilled vacancies and a crisis in training, bringing through clinicians. We've got exactly the same picture in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Why have we got it so wrong here in terms of long-term workforce planning?
So, without knowing the ins and outs of things, the precise way that the planning works in HEE and AES, some of the challenges are, I mean, let's be frank, you're never going to get workforce planning exactly right. And an outside observer might argue that the problems in the UK are probably not to the same degree as they are in the rest of the world. We estimate there's going to be about a 40 million workforce shortage by the time we get to 2030 across the world, which is quite significant. But some of the reasons why...
I'm asking the question in the context of your backcasting, you know, and tools, well, and analyses methods, and I'm thinking, why haven't we used that stuff more intelligently here? Or if we have, why has it failed?
Well, my blunt answer to that is, I don't know that you haven't used them, but if the general failure in planning tends to be because money isn't allocated, is that the process isn't followed through, that short-termism takes precedence over long-termism. And there is one of the biggest challenges we find is that there is a tight link to a strategic policy, and a plan is developed for that. But the time horizon of that policy is too short. It sits within the political environment and not within the planning environment. And most people sat around a table, this virtual table, know it takes a hell of a long time to train doctors. It doesn't take an awful lot less time to develop skilled nursing cadres either. And the planning horizon, I would suggest, is significantly longer generally, if you take into account the education pipeline, than the five-year existence of a parliament within the UK, and it's less in other countries. And the other thing is, you do get seesaw policies, and in some degrees, that's not helpful. To a degree, you might argue that if planning was left to the delivery of the healthcare without any of that political switching, then planning might be more effective.
I'm going to have to stop us there because we've got a break to do now, and then we've got Jonathan O'Reilly, who's coming along with Joe Matthews to talk about creating the conditions for safe care, and we've got Professor Richard Williams, who we're looking forward to talking about experiences that stress NHS and care staff. A fantastic topic. Chris and Gareth, thank you so much. We're going to end it there. We're going to have just a 5-minute natural comfort break, call it what you will. So let's get back here, ready to roll. 20 past, please, no later, and we'll get cracking. Thank you very much. Thank you both, Chris and Gareth. Appreciate that.
Thank you.